Hello and welcome to the Dynamic Simracers World GT Championship live on the iRacing Esports Network and live on Apex Racing TV. My name is Sam Fitzpatrick and alongside me for this evening's racing is Marco Babner, who is also on the cameras. And we're here at sunny Zolder. Marco, it's one of the staples of this circuit. We've been to this place plenty of times in this championship and it's a little bit of a change up for this round five of the championship.
Yes, absolutely. Hello, Sam. Hello, everyone, and welcome. This is going to be a fantastic one, I'm sure of it. And one of the staples, as you were saying, of this particular championship, really one of the crown jewels in terms of prestige. Of course, several drivers coming from Belgium and several of them coming from nearby countries as well. But a very, 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 very tricky racetrack, especially for GT cars. There are a lot of cars and not a lot of space available for the drivers tonight.
Exactly. So far we've witnessed a brilliant championship. Four different race winners in the first four races, and honestly, you would not bet against it being another race winner. Ashley Beard winning last time out in a chaotic start, at least at Watkins Glen. We were denied what would have been a brilliant race with a few early issues for the teams. But I think today it's going to be much better. In the lead of the championship after that is Ashley Beard. He has got a healthy margin in the championship, Mark, 60 points. I mean, that type of cushion with the two drop rounds, admittedly, or maybe just one drop round that these drivers get. I think it is two drop rounds. But in terms of the overall scores, that's such a big margin for Beard. I mean, 100 points for a win, 60 points ahead of me. That's a cushion he's going to have for the next few rounds of the championship. So do you reckon he's going to approach this round any differently? Just thinking, let's just get the points down, consistent podium finishes, rather than going for the race win? Or do you think he will be as focused as ever on winning out?
Well, you know, Sam, in a racetrack like this, I think, especially if you're not starting close to the front, and, you know, it's such a short lap, let's be honest, it's not one of those racetracks where there's really a lot of ground and corners where you can really make a difference compared to the other drivers. So if you're not at the front of the field, and it's quite possible around here, maybe a survival mentality, even this early in the championship, even though we are approaching, the halfway point, as you were saying, it's a good mentality to have. So let's keep an eye on Ashley. At the moment, he's sitting in fourth place. He just set, now in fifth, because the new boy, Joseph Janowski, we wanted to see such more from him at the Glen. Of course, his home race, one of his, I mean, it's from the beautiful country of the United States, but sadly he spun from the lead of the race in the first lap, and then it was brilliant, I have to say, damage limitation nonetheless with a wounded race car. He had to make a very, 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 very long comeback. I'm sure he's hoping for a much smoother ride this time around here in Zolder.
Yeah, we did see him on Sunday, to be fair, in the Simracers World Endurance Championship. Anyone who watched that, it was a spectacle put on by us. I like to say some of the conversation topics we got on were absolutely superb. You would never get that on race top. So certainly do watch back the last kind of 20 minutes of that race. It was a brilliant duel between, it was a few Sim Sports and who was the other team? Marco, who they were?
T3.
T3, of course. T3 Motorsports. So that was ever so close. But we also saw Janowski in that one, along with plenty of other drivers. Of course, Year One Racing were in that with Beards racing, and that crashed, I think, on Eau Rouge on the first lap of the race. Just shows difficulty of warming up the tyres, which is a factor we have seen so much so far this season. Stijn van Bjoort, he's been on good form, and he has got the last two pole positions, I believe, Marco. Hasn't quite converted it so far this season. I think he was also pretty strong at Daytona, if I'm correct on that one. But yeah, he just needs to, improve on his starts at Sebring. He dropped down to third at the start, showed himself to be the fastest driver. Last time out, he dropped it on the first couple of corners. We know Stijn is quick, and yet he's still lacking a race win in this championship.
Yeah, but he has a new weapon in his arsenal today. Of course, a weapon that has two ends, you know, two pointy ends, depends on, you know, it can be both good or bad. Just this morning, I was looking through social media, and just like you, he ditched his laptop for a proper computer this morning, you know? So it's his first race with his new... I think his gear will remain the same, you know, wheel, pedals, etc. But now he has, like, you know, a proper computer. And of course, that will take, I think, a little bit of adaptation. I don't know about you, but because you have raced so many years on the potato machine with good results, fantastic results, I should say.
Oh, thank you very much.
How was the change for you in the terms? I mean, today you are back for not very happy reasons, of course, as we all know, to your home, and so you are back to a proper computer. How was the difference for you? You know, here at Apex Racing TV, the Racing Esports Net, we make the real talk. You know, I hear these commentators, and I mean, they are fantastic, but sometimes I think they overstep their boundaries and talk about stuff that is not true or not correct, or maybe, you know, too much fantasy in what they're saying. We talk about the nitty-gritty. How was the difference in switching from a laptop to a proper assembled computer in racing for you?
Well, I'm pleased I can be of use for once, because usually on expert analysis, I'm absolutely atrocious, but I do have some expertise in this. For those who don't know, I quite often run on a laptop, and did for pretty much 3.5 years on iRacing. And I must say, when I upgraded, went from 40 FPS to 70 FPS now, the main difference, I think, is around street circuits and around really kind of tricky circuits. I think Belle Isle, I remember, so much easier now. Just the fact that you know where to turn in, that much easier. Nordschleifer as well, much more simple. However, it does improve. It does definitely improve your performance, just that extra frames per second, that slightly better defined detail just in front of you. And yeah, it can improve your time. So hopefully, yeah, that is going to be the case. For Van Buhl with his new computer, and yeah, if he can gain a couple of more tenths of a second, then he is going to be very tricky to beat. Word as well on Marco, on Martin van Leeuwenhoek, Marco, he's the winner of course last two championships, way down in the championship currently in 11th place, despite a decent showing at Watkins Glen, finishing I think 6th or 7th on that occasion. At what point do you think Van Buhl needs to start making up points? Sorry, not Van Buhl, Van Leeuwenhoek. What point do you think he needs to make up some points? Can he afford to have a couple more slack rounds and then just bring it back in the second half of the season? Or do you think he needs to start to outscore the championship leaders starting today?
Well, apparently not today, because I don't see him in the session, and so this is going to be a problem for him, because of course you already need to drop a couple of bad rounds in the beginning of the season, and if he doesn't show up, it's going to have a big goose egg for today's round, and so really complicate matters even further in his title defense for Le Champion. And I think that if he doesn't, in fact, show up tonight, I may have to start to believe what he was telling us all along, as we say hello to our fantastic, the best stewards in the world of sim racing and also real life, apart from me, that is, of course, for the real life. For the virtual, there is none better than Bert Ellman and Sebastian Herberer. Big hello to them, and they will keep updating us in the race graphics on the bottom of the screen, as you can see right now. So I might have to start to believe Martin when he said that he was not not very confident in retaining the title for this year. And now, I mean, this drop round, because this is going to be a drop round, because you scored zero, of course, if you don't show up, it's going to be make things much, much more difficult, and they were already very, very tough.
Yeah, I mean, this would it wouldn't be the nail in the coffin, because he has shown to be unbeatable for many rounds in a row. But it is a shame not to see him out here today, but has been struggling quite a bit in that Ford GT. Was decently quick at Daytona, I remember, but has kind of struggled for pace ever since then. But hopefully we do see him back quite soon. Janowski then still on provisional pole. Van Buren in second place. Ashton, who was provisional pole initially in third. PJ Clayson's got pole at Daytona. I believe has won a round so far this season. Surely he has. He's a little bit further down at the moment. Is he yet to put in a lap time?
Yes, I have to tell you something about him. Of course, I was doing some other work last night and in the Venom Works Sports Car Championship, where they run GTEs and LMP2s. And PJ Clayson's won the GTE class in a landslide. But the most important thing, maybe not only that, but that I learned that I have been mispronouncing his name all these years. And if there's something I don't like, is mispronouncing names. Because apparently I've been told by a very informed colleague of us that it is PJ Clayson's, apparently.
Of course, PJ Clayson's. Apologies. See you, PJ.
As we say hello to everyone in the chat, someone asking when Verstappen and Norris are driving. We don't have Verstappen and Norris. I would have loved to tell you that we had Le Champion, the real Le Champion, but very, very rare drop week for him. But, I mean, this Stijn Van Buren, comeback for this year. I mean, you remember he was there when we first started covering this championship together with his brother, and again, we send a big hug to Ruben Van Buren, hopefully. He will be back very, very soon, and hopefully, recovering after a real-life bicycle bike accident. But Stijn Van Buren then came back for this year, and I mean, he was always there or thereabouts when we first started covering. Of course, if you remember, he raced with the BMW, just like his brother. But this year, driving the McLaren, something has switched on for him. And he is always there or thereabouts. As you were saying, only the race victory is missing from his resume in this season. But otherwise, he has had a brilliant comeback, 0.021 of a second just behind the pole position time. Look at that. I mean, top four are in less than 0.01 of a second.
Yeah, it is ever so close. Nick Sherman's having a great time. I mean, he's obviously been very quick these last few rounds, but that is an even stronger performance from him. They're not going to quite get in another qualifying time. The checker flag is out, so this is all for Stijn Van Buren, and he does not improve. He was 0.0001 of a second slower. I'm almost certain that his optimal best lap would have put him into pole position, but it is so tricky to nail all five sectors round. This trek is having a little bit of a tough time. Is Steve Clays, who I raced against earlier on and beat. We both crashed. I crashed later.
That's a very broad definition of beating someone on the racetrack, huh?
It counts, all right?
Okay.
So he qualified ahead of me, and then I think he got spun round by someone, so I was ahead of him for a bit. I then got taken out myself. It's still a winning moment for me, despite the fact I'd lost iRacing for it. Lee Woodburn is also out on circuit currently. We'll go through the top of the silver and the bronze drivers in a bit once we go through the grid. Of course, we'll be a full formation lap around this circuit.
Of course, Sam, if you spot any wrong class, because this season it has been a bit tricky to keep up with the class changes. If you spot something that's wrong, just tell me. And I will promptly update it, because we are true professionals in here. I mean, and we don't hide anything from you. We do everything, under the sun. And if we make mistakes, they are happy mistakes. Steve Clays is having some fun there, and that was
a lot of happy mistakes for Steve Clays right now. This is the driver that I beat earlier on, of course. I will remind everyone of that several times this evening. And there's nothing that Steve can do about it, unfortunately. So we are nearly into the race. I don't think qualifying has quite expired. No, we've got 4 more seconds to go. Here we go. I'm getting used to the Yoblo, which I can now run. Me and Michael are seeing exactly what you are seeing at home, and that is thanks to the fantastic tech guys at SDK Gaming. You can check their website out, and you can get yourself an overlay like this. And this is fully customizable as well. You can change absolutely everything on it. You should see the Formula 3.5 broadcast we do. It is incredible. So certainly do check out SDK Gaming. And of course, there is a link in the description below for the live timing. So if we blabber on about nonsense, still keep up to date with what is going on. Joseph Janowski then is on pole position, 2/100ths of a second ahead of Stijn van Buell. That is Janowski's first pole position ever in this series. Jack Ashton starts in third, and then top of the silver drivers is Nick Sherman's in fourth, only 1/10th off. James Forsdyke, good qualifying for him. He's usually stronger in the race than in qualifying, so that is ominous signs for everyone else. Drews Mugidy, another strong performance for him in sixth. Then it's Ashley Bid, Bod Boland, Seb Hawkins, Neil Cooper, Matthias Tem, and Jeremy Hessel turning out the top 12. Behind that is Chris Muretta, Justin Nair, top of the silver drivers, of course. Watch out for him. Adam Murray, David Fuller, Steve Clays, John Tusting, Ronald Moons, Paul Gosling, and top of the bronze drivers, Thijs Vandenberg. And then it is Stephen DeWolf, Kevin De Winter, Pim Bao, Kim Byett, Hendrik De Grave, John McConville, Ryan Walker, James Hobden, Lee Diemer, Jochen Lennert, Simon Van Dyke, Lee Woodburn, PJ Clayton, who did not set an eligible lap time. And there we are, 34 drivers. Oh, here we are, a little bit further back. Stuart Musselwhite, Ben Llewellyn, and Rob Thiessen, and Kevin Bowden. So it should be a 38-car field for you today. And once again, as the stewards are absolutely brilliant. They're not great at handing out Commentator of the Season awards, but they can get the pace car right, because they can see the Mustang pace car at the head of the field. And it will bring them around for an entire lap of this Zolder circuit. So it's only his second race, Mark, and maybe we saw that inexperience last time out from Janowski, dropping it in the first couple of corners. Do you think he's got the mentality to win this race? Do you think he can sustain the pressure? Because it's not easy to overtake around this circuit. However, it is very easy to make mistakes. So it's going to be a long hour for him.
Yes, I agree with you, Sam. And I think that the problem is a bit more spread out, because all the GT races I've commentated in this past couple of weeks after the week 13 update, it's actually I've seen many drivers, even experienced drivers, struggling with these cold tires. This pace lap is not nearly enough to get them tires into temperature, so I think that hopefully drivers will have learned from their mistakes in the new tire model era. And of course, there's also been a little bit of a... It happens once per season, so I wouldn't worry too much about it, but the stewarding team has sent their traditional once per season stern warning to all the drivers to basically, to quote Jerry Nadeau, use their heads at the restart, you know, and don't do anything silly, because especially in this place here, it's massively important to keep your head cool when you are in a 30-something, almost 40 GT3 car field. Again, narrow racetrack, so not only the problem of the chicane that you could have, but also if someone spins, especially in the middle portion of the lap, you have to call the police, because there will be basically a roadblock. You see, it's very, very narrow, even in this section here. So, eyes open from the drivers. Hopefully everything is okay. Thank you for joining us. And now it's time to go racing, finally, for this fifth round of the season, as the beautiful, well, we don't have Martin van Loosen, but we still have one Ford, and what a Ford, what a beautiful Mustang we have, leading the field for just one lap. And here we go.
It peels off into the pits. It's Janowski to control the field. He hesitates. It's his choice when to go. The green flag is about to come out. And we are away from round five of the Dynamic Simracers World GT Championship. Janoski pulls away.
Ashton already getting past Van Buren.
There's a massive crash down the pit straight, and we may well need a safety car in this situation, as there is an almost complete roadblock at the moment. The drivers just finding a way past, but they're having to slow such to. Well, I think they have got three.
I have to say, given the premises, that went much better than I was expecting. Of course, bad. They had the cold tires catching out Moretta. These cold tires are really catching these drivers unawares once again, just as we saw last week and in the Endurance Series. And you know, it's a very short lap around here, Sam. So, I mean, some of the cars are still basically sitting on in turn one and starting only right now. Lap traffic will become a problem very, 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 very soon. And at the front, nothing has changed apart from poor Chris Moretta spinning out in the third corner of the lap. And as you can see, Janowski, Ashton, Van Buel and the rest of the crew are already completing their first lap.
Yeah, Janowski after a comfortable getaway. He has been pegged in a little bit. So Ashton managed to make the mistake on Van Buel. Sherman's and Paul Stikes remaining in fourth and fifth. Beard up a place into sixth, championship leader, of course. Great start for Jeremy Hessels as well. He's up five places. So I think the incident which kind of triggered that big started just on the outer edges of the top 10, because Bob Boland has had a massive issue. I think Moretta just got his way through, gained about five places in the first few corners, and then proceeded to drop it. So here we are going to try to see what happened. And I think that was Boland straight away, and maybe Neil Cooper as well, making contact and just bouncing from one side to the other. Credit to the other drivers behind. They did a pretty good job at slowing down as much as they could.
So yeah, the contact, yeah, there was the Fury car and the Meraki car that made contact. And I have to say that again, in the bad, because this is a bad crash, of course, we have at the start of the race, the majority of the drivers really used cooler heads prevailed. Of course, it's very sad for those that basically at the race ended straight away, even before the start finish line for some, as looks like Ashton wants to make a move on Janowski. But you know, we will hear it many times around here, making moves in this place not the easiest things, especially with these big cars.
Yeah, certainly is the case. Maybe Formula 3 cars a little bit more simple. But in these GT3 cars, yeah, ever so tricky. Kind of got turn one, perhaps a good opportunity. But even if you get, as long as you defend the inside into turn one, it's a wide entry into turn one, so it is tricky to defend. But if you have the inside line, really a long run down into two, and then you have to follow the same line through three and four. And then the chicane at the end of this straight, that's getting really close now, is Ashton. And Janowski, though, kind of just got to put his car in the middle of the circuit. Ashton could just dive it down the inside and give Janowski no choice but to turn out of the corner. However, he's a much more respectable driver than that. So Van Buel behind, failing to really put too much pressure on these guys. 1.5 seconds off the lead, as off the track is Dries Moujdi. And that was from second place in the silver category. He's still in third place. He's dropped back now behind David Fuller, though. And this is how it happened. Not too much damage on that car, at least. You can see the rear wing quite creased. But we'll continue in this race quite normally. One pit stop in this race, of course. Expect it to come pretty late on in the event, as we see the start will be reviewed after the race. Another off now for Kim Byhet. And he had got a good start, was up about five places. And that is another mistake, as the tyres, maybe it's just still warming up, and wait, would have got to slow down anyway right there, and then failed to quite turn the car around in order to avoid the wall.
How happy are you, Sam, that you can read the wonderful messages from our amazing race stewards?
Unbelievable. It is incredible.
Gives you a sense of inner peace that really you were missing during these broadcasts.
and the cameras are good. Oh, it's all coming together. And we're not having any SIBO issues anymore, I believe.
Unbelievably, it's holding on. iRacing looking into it.
I mean, that's a jinx if I've ever heard.
No, no, usually if the problem is not there at the start, it's not there. You know, there's a patch coming tomorrow from iRacing. I'm not holding my hopes high, because I think this is going to be a long fix. There must be something in the inner workings of iRacing that is it has been broken, because finally other people are starting to report, not just us, and of course some of the drivers also. I mean, no, not so many of the drivers have reported issues, especially in you know, big field races like the TCR races that we have here on Thursday, no? And that is, I mean, you know, because at the beginning it was said, you know, maybe it's just a commentator's problem because of the software you use, the iRacing officials said to us, and that, you know, when the drivers start having problems, then you realize that maybe there's something else that's not quite right with the sim.
Yeah, and of course, if you've if you've got any issues with your C-bar, do check out the iRacing forums, go to the problem reporting, and I think you can just give your feedback. With any feedback you can give to iRacing, I'm sure they will really appreciate.
I have done my part. I have donated my iRacing core files to the iRacing staff to have them studied. So, you know. I did my... Oh,
Janowski! Slow, slow, and that's basically gone. And it's a mistake from Joseph Janowski. And he's given up the race lead. It's Jack Ashton who leads the race winner from Bathurst. And it is one of the most common mistakes. He didn't seem to do a whole lot wrong, Marco. But that those curves are so threatening. And Janowski has made a critical mistake right there.
Yeah, and of course now not a big issue with these cars, but it could be possible, of course, with the Formula cars, if you do something like that, you bend your front wing with the new damage model, you bend the suspensions, you break them. Not as much as of an issue with these cars, but still you can't abuse those curbs, even with these big GT cars.
So I'm in Van Dijk having some issues, and this is him. And got a little bit of a wallop as well from behind. And of course the grass so slippery now, it's really tricky to get back onto the circuit once you are off. So Ashton with the fastest lap of the race, a 28.37 that last time round. And I wonder if Janowski will take a different line round the chicane this next tour. Good to see three different cars in the top three places. Yeah, how much curb do they take this time? Janowski, maybe a little bit less, but not a significant change, sticking by his guns.
You know,
behind him, James Forsdijk versus Ashley Beard. I wonder, both year one drivers, would it be better for these guys to change places?
Yeah, maybe it's Fernando is faster than you moment is coming. You know, I think more than that, it's the fact that I think Janowski carried too much speed there at the chicane, more than... I mean, yes, the line was of course a bit too aggressive and you don't want to abuse the curves that way, but if you carry too much... You remember how we basically came to almost a stop. I think he was afraid he went in too deep, as still maintaining positions are the two year one cars, especially because they are closing in on... on Sherman's, as we have an overtake attempt here by Sebastian Hawkins, and they are still side by side, so you can pass there, you need to be extra brave. And Hawkins tried to complete the move, but now of course Matthias Tem will have the inside, and lurking there is Murray. Oh, brave cutback by the Abruzzi car, and nothing changes.
Yeah, Hawkins has been trying to get past for that entire lap. He did get past and now falls back behind. And as he said, the year one driver, Adam Murray, is pretty close to them as well. Beard has got past Forsdijk and now getting past some traffic. That is Stephen DeWolf going quite slow. We'll just tries to complete as many laps as he can just to score some points. And, well, the change happened. This one says they're listening along. And I think that probably was the wise decision for the championship as well. James Forsyth, of course. Well, I guess these guys are both rookies, but I still think Beard, many years of experience in the MX-5s. And if anyone's going to avoid any collisions, it is going to be Ashley Beard. Very wise head on him. Oh, and now a spin for Tem. And benefiting from this is going to be Adam Murray. And you feel bad for Mateus Tem because that was a nice battle going on. And Seb Hawkins hasn't even gained a place out of it. And now he's going to lose a place from it because there goes David Fuller, leader of the Silver drivers, and the Quantum Racing driver is up into the top 9 places, up 7 places from his start. Dropping to 13th place there was Tem.
Trying to give you some hints without correcting you with my voice about the silver standings.
Oh, apologies.
You have the graphics, man. I mean, this is
I do.
This is inexcusable today.
All right, okay, Nick Sherman's the leader of the Silver Drivers. Give me a rest, all right?
Of course, Hawkins defending now from Fuller, and as we were saying many times, the Quantum Racing driver, I think, one of the quickest, in the Silver category, it has been one of the quicker drivers for, almost... 2 seasons now. Unfortunately, he has had some very, very bad luck, especially last year, but also this year, even though he finally cracked that first silver win earlier in the championship. But still, of course, we are always hoping and wishing him the best because he has a very big talent. And as we see, I wanted to show a replay of that overtake. There we go.
Yeah, he kind of... I don't think Hawkins was even going for the move, to be honest, but the door's always going to shut with Tem going wide initially. And, we'll be quite frustrated with that one. The Abruzzi driver loses out, and then, of course, some good opportunistic driving from Quantum Racing to get ahead for David Fuller. I think also Tem has just got past Gosling. So that's an important move for Tem back up into 12th place. He might yet get revenge on Seb Hawkins. However, he is some 10 seconds behind at the moment. Out in front, the Senna-esque livery of Stijn van Buell. Still sitting behind Joseph Janowski. He's still lacking a livery, which is a bit of a shame. Hopefully we will get a livery on that machine very, very soon.
Yes,
Ashton, 1.4 seconds ahead. They pretty much were all in the 28 fives in that last tour.
Driving for Fury Simsport, I forgot to say that, is Janowski. So he should have a very nice black livery coming his way very soon, just as this one, for example, of Mathias Tem.
Ooh, wide for Hawkins, and Fuller's got back past. I don't think we saw Hawkins get past in the first place. Aha, car number 10 needs to give place back to number... Ooh, that's a harsh penalty for Seb Hawkins, who spun Mateus Tem, of course. And the stewards have decided to give him a penalty that he has to serve. And that's, you can see the distance that he's going to have to give up now, is Seb Hawkins. I'm sure he will say that how he lost out to Fuller was because of that. But he will have to do that probably sooner rather than later. And this happened. Great camera work from Marco Barbonet. And it was a pretty obvious penalty, I think, for Hawkins. Perhaps the stewards being a little bit harsher with these penalties. Perhaps in the near future, we'll see if that does turn out to be the case. But that is certainly an example of it.
I agree with the decision. And I'm not trying to pander to the stewards, but I think that was a good call from them. Let's say that I was asked to judge... I mean, of course, when there is a crash, you ask 100 people, you're going to get 100 different opinions, more or less. well, maybe not 100, but you know, it's going to be, the more you watch, I've noticed, you know, this is something that you pick up, especially when you start really, you know, I used to study sociology in university, and I'm a big sports fan. And you know, I've noticed that the big decisions in soccer, you know, the referee mistakes or you know, points of contention, I've noticed, and I put my family through some kind of testing without telling them, basically, no. And I've noticed that the more you see a certain replay of a certain event, and the more you reinforce your opinion on that, if you have already a preconceived idea about what happened. That was to say,
okay,
that I mean, that's very rudimentary, yeah? And of course, you know, it's not being scientifically approved by any kind of commission, my study, but I mean, that's when you see the replay, of course, you can watch it 100 times, and it's this very long thought was to say that you can watch a replay 100 times, it's not going to make your mind 100% clearer on what happened. In my opinion, it has the opposite effect, because it's certainly not you know, clear. But in that case, if I was the steward, I would have given the penalty.
Yeah, I was doing some stewarding for the ARLTC. Yeah, that would be a good old 3 license points plus 20 penalty points plus whatever positions he lost for that one. Akin by height has just made another mistake. Down 23rd place. He's alright though, he hasn't lost a place. Still up 2 places from his start. By the way, biggest gainers so far, of course, Murray and Fuller up 7 places each. They are in 8 and 9. And then we've also got 17th place gain for PJ Clayson. So he's up into 17th place now. There is Justin Nair, who got involved in that first lap shunt, and with plenty of damage on that car. No faster pairs as well for these drivers. It's going to be a tricky finish to the race for him. There is Clayson's, Clayson's, I think we agreed earlier on. Still wants to cover a few more places, to recover as many points as he can. Same situation as Bathurst, wasn't it? Where he didn't set a qualifying time, Marco. So, I'm pretty sure it's deliberate on both counts. So he's getting used to these drives through the field round tight, twisty circuits.
Yeah, I mean, that's one way of doing it. I mean, of course, you need to be extra sure that whatever you do, you're going to gain positions in the race. So there is always this big point of contention, especially on oval racing, which I race a lot. And the question is, especially in big fields, do you want to set a qualifying time and start hopefully towards the front, or start towards the back and take it easy? Because I think there are positives and negatives in both areas. Because of course, starting at the front, you risk of course the more tough, hard racing with the quicker drivers. Hawkins is going very slowly.
I think he's just got the message that he's got to give up the place, and this is one way of giving up the place. Maybe
the winger?
I don't know. That was Mushdie just behind him, of course, who was catching him anyway. And so he's back to the pits. He may well have had enough several, because he has disconnected from the session, which is a shame. And they got a drive-thru penalty for not giving up the place to Matthias Tem, of course.
Back to my point. So I don't know why tonight I'm, you know, maybe because I did. I'm doing every day these 1 hour and a half broadcasts of these American
series.
We are going crazy. And I cannot talk. It's just the cameras, no. So I have to, you know, recover from my 1 hour and a half of silence. Point is, you know, if you start at the front, you met. Yes. Of course, seems a good idea. You think the positive, of course, is that there are less cars in front of you. The negative being, of course, that you will fight a bit harder for those positions. In the back, it's the opposite. Maybe you can take it easier, but if there is a problem, like we've seen today, you have many, many more cars to dodge and avoid. Oh, Ashley Beard is has gone wide, and it's not the first time he's made this mistake. In fact, he made the same mistake a couple of laps back, a different corner. There he is. And now he made he had another off track coming out of turn 2 and 3.
And pushing hard.
Ooh, that was a bit scary. Pushing hard, trying to get back to Nick Sherman's, but all the nice words we said about him driving a little bit carefully, more carefully than usual because of his championship position. Not looking particularly, true, as we are seeing Ashley really, really pushing hard. I tell you what, let's watch it again in a second, but from his onboard and see.
Oh, McConville has had an off. He was John McConville in 16th place previously. However, this incident has occurred to him.
Oh, there he is. Hiding from us, and he already has some damage probably in the thinking about it, he had that issue at the very beginning of the race. Of course, he was involved in the mess at the start. Want to go back to that off by Ashley Beard. Yeah, that was bit scary, but he lived to tell the tale as Murray and Fuller are still going at it.
Well, of course, with a fifth place finish, I believe it was at Bathurst. Did retire though at Daytona after running in the top 10 in the early stages. I don't think he's had a great last couple of rounds either. So he could do with the points. Certainly going to be a challenger to Justin Nyer in the silver category this season, along with Sherman's, as well as 299 car of Lee Deamer. It's having a tricky time. Excite iRacing. And, this was on board with Nyer, how he managed to get past. Just a common mistake there down at turn two, and we'll be frustrated with that one. Undoubtedly, we'll leap. Tyre should be in a pretty good operating window at the moment. Not too much degradation on them yet, and yet they will be certainly fully up to temperature. That is certainly what Nick Sherman's will be hoping he's got, at least. You can see 25 degrees track temperature, 18 degrees air temperature. So it's pretty cool for these drivers, much cooler than it often is. Does seem as though Beard has much the upper hand in these conditions. They are now the 10 seconds off the race lead. It is certainly the top three in a league of their own. But Beard, if you could just get a fourth place, would be really good points for the championship. As he gets closer and closer to Sherman, so he is now under massive pressure. And into the hairpin is one of the few overtaking opportunities around this circuit. Beard had a look. He's not going to get a much better opportunity than that. Of course, Marco Sherman is a very experienced driver himself, been around this championship for a long time. This is one of the first times, I think, this season where he's been leading in the silver category. Do you think that will factor into his mind?
Well, I mean, everything we say, of course, the opposite happens today.
Yeah.
But you know what? I think that he knows that Ashley has made a couple of mistakes. Ashton gets a 28.13, fastest lap of the race so far. He knows, and we have seen how quick Ashley is. Despite his two mistakes going off the track, he has been able to close the gap very, very quickly to that Audi in front of him. I'm not so sure certainly Nick is not going to move out of the way, but maybe Ashley is getting a bit frustrated because I know he has the pace, and he knows he has the pace, but he is not finding a good spot to make the pass, and he tried to poke out of the slipstream there at the hairpin, but simply you need to be much closer than what he was there, so the move was not not going to happen, unfortunately for him. Let's see if he will be patient like this, as we are already almost approaching the halfway mark of this event. And of course, Sam, we have talked about tires in the beginning of the broadcast for the reasons that we said earlier, the tires of course being much tougher to warm up now. Fuller making a move.
Yeah, pass Adam Murray, good pace right now for David Fuller. And yeah, he has just gained that place then. Pass Murray, you can see Mujdi only just behind them as well after an earlier spin, I believe, for Dries Mujdi, because he spun at the chicane. You think he'd be quite far clear of these guys if it weren't for that. And that last lap, Mujdi, who's in the 28, that's not far off the leader's pace. 29.73 this time, so a little bit slower. But was much faster than Adam Murray, at least. And we go back to Sherman's.
Going back to my point, of course, the tyres then will come into play now again, because as you know, with the new tyre model, iRacing is trying to make life a little bit tougher for these GT car drivers, both GTE, GT3, and I guess also GT4 and GT1. The tyres will be degrading at a much quicker rate, of course, with the nice weather that we are having today, nice in terms of racing, and also a little bit of the sun coming out from the clouds right now. Maybe the tire life will be a bit longer, but still, oh, here we go, Beard. No, again, he pokes out of the draft there. No dice again this time. So, again, it's in, especially for these 1 hour races in this championship and other championships, as we say hello to Matthew for subscribing on YouTube to Apex Racing TV. Hopefully, you are enjoying. Of course, we are simulcasting on our channel as well. So, you are welcome to join us on the Esports Network, on Apex Racing TV. YouTube channels, and of course on our own Apex Racing TV's Twitch channel. So hello to you if you're watching there, and of course to our Facebook page. So again, very long point I'm making today. It's still not in the area of it's okay to change tires because you will lose a lot of time, but of course more tire wear will make it even more important to manage your tire the more you go into the race. And of course you want to arrive at the end with a decent, at least decent, tire life left, because that's usually in this championship, especially, Sam, when things get very, very interesting.
Yeah, you want to have some good pace near the end of the race, and maybe, whereas before you didn't really care about the tire life whatsoever, it is something that the drivers factor into their setups a lot more than they did previously. You can see behind Beard, Forsdyke is now only was one second faster on that last lap. And I just wonder, Beard really puts me off Sherman's, because Sherman seems to be missing a lot of Apex. He's doing enough to stay ahead. However, Beard this time, maybe into the final chicane. Nope. Just doesn't want to go for it at the moment. And the way that these corners are positioned, you can kind of defend and then get a decent exit stop, certainly from that final chicane. Once you just slow it down in the middle of the chicane, you are going to be absolutely fine, not under threat from your opponent. And just wonder if Beard does need to go a little bit more risky. You doubt Sherman's would necessarily put up a massive fight. It's not as though this is the end of the world for him. Maybe if this was for the silver class victory, then he'd defend a bit harder. If Beard did go for an ambitious move, you'd imagine the Audi driver to leave him a bit of space. They're coming up to some back marker just ahead. That's Simon van Dijk for Rev Match. He will want to get out of the way. Here he is. And does a pretty good job on that occasion. Out in the lead, by the way, Ashton's been putting in some pretty phenomenal lap times. Gap now up to 3 seconds. He's extended it significantly. There you can see a massive lap 16 where he set the fastest lap of the race, and Janowski just failing to match him recently, was faster on the last time round. Van Buur has a big wiggle coming out of this corner. Of course, Ruben Van Buur won at Zolder, I think the last time we visited here, Marco. So there's some reputation on the line for the Van Buur family right now to retain that crown.
I'm sure that Ruben is pulling for his brother watching the race. By the way, let me say a fantastic thank you to the Apex Racing TV Resistance. We have 19 people watching on our own channel, so I mean, keep the fight strong, and thanks for giving us a little bit of the viewing numbers for today's race. I mean, Beard, maybe he knows that the stewards are in a very, wouldn't say bad mood, but of course they have an extra special close eye on proceedings tonight, so he doesn't want to. They're always in a great mood, our stewards, they are fantastic.
Well, they're always junk, aren't they? All that beer they got up there.
So maybe he doesn't want to force the issue, or maybe he really is playing into a more safer kind of racing. I mean, if he can, he can make the pass, but he's happy where he is. Of course, he has the big plus of having James Forsdijk, his teammate, right behind him, so he knows that he's not under any threat. James is probably now working as a bodyguard to Ashley, so he can have his own race. The fight I'm waiting to see explode, especially in the pit stops now, is this one, because of course not a very high fuel consumption track this one, Sam, given that it's pretty, you know, not very quick start and stop. The throttle is not open for Beard went into the pits. Okay, so that's again opposite of what I was saying.
Well, I think there's a strategic element. I think that's the point you're making, wasn't it, Mark?
Say hello to Mark Fletcher, by the way, in the chat, who now I think is the man.
Team principal.
Yeah, he's the new team principal, the man with the plan for year one racing. So yeah, Beard is in, and not alone, because that's Lee Dimmer, who is one lap down, coming out of the pits right now. But I want to see this fight explode. I mean, Van Buell again, this is not a massive fuel-saving track, but some creative lines there. Jump on board with the McLaren.
Hopefully we get to know how fast Van Buell is in this race. He wasn't particularly strong at the start of the event, not putting too much pressure on the top two. Ever since then, he's just been bottled up behind them stairs. I just wonder, is this a bit like Sebring, where he's in third place, can't get up into second, and by the time he does get into second place, it's too late. Good news for Van Buell, so he should need less fuel at the pit stop, seeing that he's been in so much slipstream. One element, Marco, which I think is absolutely superb about this circuit, and I don't think gets enough chats about, because it is so unique. The pit lane entry. If you're following another car, if you come into the pits, you're losing probably 2 seconds because of the fact that you can't go flat out into the pits. And so that is something to bear in mind. And it is painful when you come into the pits and you think, I'm going to do some aggressive undercut on this bloke. And you have to brake for the pit lane, which is about 50 miles up the road. But that is certainly something that the drivers will have to think about. Maybe we'll undo the effects of the undercut. There is Juice Moustier, by the way, getting past Anamai. He's had very good paces. Moustier wouldn't bet against him, perhaps. Catching up as into the pits comes PJ Clayson. So I think that is a good call from him. However, I believe he had to break for the pit lane as well. So that is 2 seconds that you lose, and it's difficult to make up those 2 seconds.
And that chicane there, I mean... The end of many races for me, unfortunately. As you can
and
see,
and the
yeah.
weird building as well in the middle of the pit lane, which
I mean, remember when they first released the Tsukuba? They had that basically a little bit of a construction work in the middle of pit lane that was collidable, but sometimes you were assigned that pit stall, so basically you couldn't pit. And it's still there, so you just go through. I appreciate iRacing's decision to keep the authenticity with leaving that piece of structure there, but it's a bit weird when you have to pit through basically that or pass through that structure there in Japan. We have in the chat Ruben Van Buell updating us on his comeback and correcting Sam.
I really thought he'd won here. Who won here 2 seasons ago? You know, when Van Buell had the connection issue.
It was a surprise winner, huh?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it wasn't Van Buell, aka a surprise winner. Again, I think we say it every single time. Record history books, please. Someone must know who won around this circuit two seasons ago. Or was it even last season? I'm not sure if we even came here last season.
No, it was one. It was off. It was, you know, put into the penalty box for one season. This racetrack.
Okay.
It was one of the historic drivers of the championship. That's yeah. For sure. Gregory Ranks, someone is saying.
I think it was a BMW. Hence why I said Van Buell, whereas Ranks was a Mercedes. We will get to the bottom of this by the end of this race. Nearly 6 seconds now between the top two. Jack Ashton has been relentless, constantly in the 28s. It's not necessarily fastest lap after fastest lap, but it's such consistent mid-28s, occasional high 28s. The others are dipping into the 29s occasionally, and that's how he's building up this gap. On that last lap, he extended the lead by another 6 tenths of a second.
Oh, there's Justin Neuer!
And he's over the bumps, over the curbs, and he reverses into the gravel. Probably wasn't the best thing to do, because he now has to let plenty of drivers past. And he's towed back to the pits. And that is a big change for one of the championship contenders in the silver category. Heck, even the overall championship, it wasn't a great qualifying for him. And goes in deep, hits the curb, and I think was probably pretty frustrated with the car by this point.
Yeah, too bad, because that was a great pass, but of course too much mustard on it. Apparently that curb betrayed him, and you know, I think he said, okay, the car is very damaged. Still there were some valuable points on offer, but I can imagine a bit of frustration. I think he was also involved in that first lap. Lap.
Oh, they're both in.
Okay.
That's strange. Ashton stayed out. And, well, to be fair, Van Buell surely will have to take a couple of seconds less fuel. And he came in about 1 second behind. So this could be a good strategy from Stijn Van Buell, to be fair. Also coming into the pits is Sherwin's, Forsdijk and Hessels. So really, they were just absolutely maxing out on fuel and couldn't go any further. David Fuller stayed out. Dries Mustey has stayed out. Will mean that the drivers coming back out onto the circuit will have quite a bit of free air. And here we are then. Who's going to get out first, Janowski or Van Buell? Should be 18 seconds or so. They're up to 16, 17, 18. And Van Buell's gone, and he's ahead. And this is a long pit stop. In fact, for Janowski, I say it's long. 3 seconds longer. And that is the fuel saving for you. So the McLaren gets ahead. He's up into second place. Needs to be very careful of this exit now. Don't cross that white line. And it means that, he'll be up into second place when this is complete. Where is everyone else mixing out to? We're currently watching Ashley Beard, and he is still ahead of James Forsdijk, but only just.
Yeah, and massively behind Schurmans.
Yeah.
So it didn't work, the undercut, as the race leader makes his way into the pits. Man, it's so narrow, two don't fit in there.
It's the pit entry mark, I was saying, how you lose a couple of seconds coming into the pits when you're following another drive, and probably did lose him a little bit of time for Ashley Beard there. Here is David Fuller, of course, and he stayed out again. Wow, he's got a lot of fuel, hasn't he? Mujdi is into the pits, so Fuller leads. Haven't said that for, can't remember ever saying that. I'm sure it has happened before. Again, record books, please. But I'm pretty sure first time this season, at least, that David Fuller's led a race. It's a bit disconcerting because no one else has gone this amount of laps. Ashton, quick pit stop, 18.1. He is well clear. And it is a deceiving pit entry, but there's no deceiving there of the gap. And he even kept it well within the white lines as well. So this is turning into what could be quite a comfortable race victory for Jack Ashton. It would mean that he would be the second the first driver to win two races this season, this round five of the championship. He'd still be a long way behind Ashley Beard in the title race. However, I guess if you can include the two drop rounds, he would be ahead. Now the Quantum drivers line astern. But this is one driver a lap down. Who is that just ahead?
Paul Gosling.
Paul Gosling, who's having a terrific race, by the way, I will just say. Paul Gosling was up in 11th place.
Oh dear.
And he's held up his own teammates. Again, just the pit entry here.
Man, I started to think about that pit entrance in Shanghai, no? When they show from the distance, it looks like dry, and also in Sepang and many of the tilkdroms, if you look from the start finish line, it always seemed like someone was going like straight with no brakes and crashing into the wall.
Even under safety car, you just say, "Oh my god!" going off to South Korea as well, a good one where you have to brake round a flat out corner to get into the pits. Good memories.
People are asking about the incident points. Unfortunately, I'm not a session admin, therefore I cannot display them to you. I can only display the rough estimate that we get from the GPS positioning of the cars, but that wouldn't take into consideration crashes, and it would be at best wildly inaccurate. So unless Sam has got the powers of reading them perfect, then your only hope are our fantastic race stewards, and hopefully they will find a break in their decision making to update us on the incident points for tonight, as Jack Ashton goes past a lapped car there. He's got 7.9 seconds over Stijn van Buell. Josef Janowski is sitting in third, he's rounds up the podium, and in, let's say, 10 minutes time we'll give you the traditional recap of all the classes. As you can see, the pit stop counter for the drivers, well, everyone who's still racing has at least got one in, so pretty much this is the situation that we imagine to have. It's basically a straight fight to the finish, as Nick Sherman's here again, despite the you know, not despite Beard not gaining a lot in the pits, losing in fact, as you can see again now, Beard starting to push once again, and I expect that gap to come down and come down. Will, now that we only have a few minutes left, when, if Beard catches Sherman's, will he then go for the move or stay patient out there?
Steven DeWolf is off the circuit. He is four laps down. Seems to be all right now. Does DeWolf? He's recovered. One lap down, one place down from his start. Oh dear.
Well, he has not recovered.
That is not a recovery. That's the opposite of recovery. That's just going from bad to worse. And he's back into the pits, and that might be day over for Steven DeWolf. By the way, has Fuller jumped Hessels in the pits? Because he's now 1.8 seconds ahead. His pit stop was 3 seconds quicker play for Fuller. So I'm just wondering if he's managed to do the undercuts, also the overcuts on Jeremy Hessels right there.
First of all, let me say a big thank to Trip Campbell for subscribing to us on Apex Racing TV on YouTube, another member of the Resistance. Yes, it is another wrestling term, by the way, but it has nothing to do with Le Champion. This is stuff from almost 20 years ago. La Resistance, yeah, it was a French-Canadian stable in the WWE in the early 2000s. You were making your point about Jeremy Hessels.
I don't want to be mean to Jeremy Hessels. I can't remember him in this race. He's very quietly gone about his business, very impressively, but quite a quiet eighth place for him.
Look at this graphic here, you will see he pitted on lap 25. So maybe you can have an idea about your theory about his drop of one position.
Well, yeah, I mean, Fuller went longer than everyone else. So yeah, two laps, and then I'm not quite sure. Yeah, if it was done under the pit lane, but he has pulled away since then. Has a decent pace for him in the low 29s. By the way, Stan Van Buurt just 28.1, only a few hundredths of a second off the very fastest lap time of the race. The gap is down to 6.5 seconds. So is this another Sebring? Is this another race win that perhaps has got away from Stijn Van Buurt, where he's been the fastest driver out on circuit? I mean, this is perhaps a little bit early to say. Ashton now puts in a 28.68, just insanely consistent for Jack Ashton, remarkably consistent. There's no doubt that Janowski can get close to him on occasional laps, but it's that consistency that Ashton has possessed so far in this race. Van Buurt with a 28.39, so another 0.3 faster. And there he is. He's taking slices, thinly cut slices out of that gap. You can barely see him in the background. Further enforcing how quick Stijn Van Buurt is.
Don't talk about food, because I still have to have dinner. So.
Oh. If you can get any, Marco, with the current situation.
Yeah.
Had a Chinese early run, actually, which was quite nice.
Yeah.
Still some takeaways open.
I might have to resort to... the problem is that there is such little turnaround for some of these that basically my idea of dinner was eating Milka cookies during the earlier broadcast, since I didn't have to talk.
Right, okay, yeah. Any more of that cake?
No, it's well over. I mean,
wow.
Cakes around here last for 2 days tops. Another lap, 28.2. And Van Buurt will he gain for the fourth lap in a row? Of course, lap 27 doesn't count. No, he lost 2 seconds.
Gosh.
Probably
bad lap.
Issues with lap traffic, because I don't see any mistake, any incident. You can see he's dealing with that lapped car there. And that is Kevin Jochen Lennartz. Yes, absolutely right.
He's doing pretty well in 20th place. A lot of drivers one lap down. Remember, some of the drivers lost pretty much a lap before the race even started, because they had to stop on the green flag because of the pileup we had. And Van Buurt just can't get past at the moment. That McLaren's meant to be the passing machine. And certainly PJ Clayton's has shown that, but he just cannot get past him. He's lost another 1.5 seconds on this lap. And Lennartz isn't really doing anything wrong. The blue flags mean that a faster car is approaching, but you do not have to slow down necessarily. He does eventually get past, but that is, certainly any hope of catching up to the race leader gone. And perhaps shows how quick Jack Ashton was through that traffic a few minutes ago when he had to deal with it. Here is PJ Clayson's then.
Off.
Oh, it's the race leader. And it's Ashton. It's down to 2.5 seconds. So, if it weren't for the back markers, well, certainly he would have lost the race lead right there. And after me bigging up how consistent he's been, he's absolutely made a clumsy mistake losing the rear end. And he was fortunate
almost that collecting that Mercedes.
James Hobden did not hit him, gets back going. And maybe there is hope for Stijn Van Buurt to catch up to the race leader. He undoubtedly will be very, very concerned after that mistake.
Okay, so one thing I've noticed is that when I make mistakes, especially, and I make a lot of them, of course, with the BMW in the fixed championship now of the BMW, so new tire model, etc. Of course, tires now a bit different, even the new tire model. Each car is like, or each category has different tires, so it's not the same. But, I've noticed that after I make a mistake like this, I have to drive so carefully for like half a lap. Otherwise, I am slipping and sliding every which way. So let's see if Ashton has to tread carefully around in this lap after making his mistake. As Van Buurt has got rid of the lapped car, and let's see, of course, that those 6 seconds he gained there skewed massively by that mistake. And once again he comes back at the chicane. Let's see this time around if Ashton is back into his normal race rhythm.
So it needs 28 would be fine for him. There's a 28.6. That's strong. That's back to his normal pace. Van Buren a little bit slow, but he did have to deal with some traffic. Pretty much lost him time through the middle part of the track. Still PJ Clayson's Tem is off the track. Now, is he going to position his car in a defensive place? Yes, he does. And there's very little that the McLaren can do here. He does go around the outside, but, well, Tem has bad reminders of that corner earlier on, but it's gone much better for him on this occasion. Van Buren with another mistake, I think. Gets up to 3.1. He's lost about 0.3 just in this opening sector of the lap.
Take a closer look at the car, because Mark Fletcher is reporting maybe some damage on the front right of Ashton.
Yeah, a little bit, I think.
Yeah, I mean...
I don't think it's big damage.
No. And it didn't make contact with the lap traffic car that is now letting him by. Even though it was close. But yeah, there must be some damage there. Maybe some contact with a lap traffic. You know what? I think he got that by jumping aggressively over a curve.
Yeah, probably. Oh, Tem Clayson's. It was very close. It's still very close. Here comes Clayson's, and Tem closes the line. Oh, very close to the wall, and that's very easy to get sucked into the wall over the crest. Now Clayson's back down the inside.
Oh,
is there
banger.
Any room being left? And they both cut the circuit. Oh, well, that was all a little bit clumsy. Really, Tem had to cut the circuit there. And now he's trying to serve the slowdown, as off is Thijs Vandenberg from 14th place. He's dropped behind Paul Gosling because of that. Oh, and back comes Clayson's. Oh, not this again, please, is what Tem is saying. And, well, they are still alongside. Tem should have the best
of line,
but they're still making contact. And this is getting a little bit out of hand and very personal.
Oh.
And they're unnecessarily making contact all the way down. Clayton's around the outside. And now
there we go.
I
knew it was going to happen.
And there you go. And they're both going to lose out from it. And, dear, and they're still making contact. Well, Clayton's has got past. And somehow they haven't lost any places. Do it, seeing that they both should have lost. A handful of places right there. Well, I guess Clayson's isn't going to catch up anymore. You can see Clayson's there trying to close the line. And then once he went off the circuit, not really a whole lot you can do there, but still was on the power of the circuit. And, well, hopefully they can look back on this race and see how silly that all was.
I can feel the wrath of the stewards all the way here in Italy. They will not have a kind look and loot. Tem is not very happy, as you can see how hard he is pushing. So the recommendation made by the stewarding team before the race, not widely understood or accepted, or maybe despite the message being very harsh. I mean,
that's the first start, and then two incidents since then. So I don't think it's going to be too bad.
No, but these things you don't. I mean, as much as again, I have to reiterate this every time. I'm a novel guy, so I'm okay for a little bit of contact. And some door banging, I'm perfectly fine with it. But when it becomes excessive, like it was there, because when they started the banging doors here, I knew that there was going to happen something bad at the chicane. And let's say that neither driver did. All he could in order to avoid contact there after they made that big hit at the chicane. So it's almost like they say, okay, we are at it. Let's solve this in a straight fight. And then of course they had the dessert hitting each other again when they were getting back onto the proper racing line. Again, that will be for the stewards to decide. Expect. Oh, it's already 5 minutes left. These races are so entertaining. And it's.
Good luck from Van Buren. Would have been fast up the race if it didn't involve picking up an incident, I believe. 28.01. And his fast up is 28.10. So, must have just picked up an incident, I guess, on that lap. 2.5 seconds now, the gap between two leaders. So it's still decently sized. And actually, I think Van Buell's just a bit slower through this first few parts of the track. And then it's around this middle part where you can start making a bit of time back. Seems to be pretty good through the chicanes, I'd say, which is helpful around this track because there are plenty of them. Certainly trying to rival Montreal on that front. And you can see from the minimap, we have to deal with a little bit more traffic. 19th place is further up ahead. And then that is Simon Van Dyke. And then they've also got 15th place. Oh dear. Yep. That is
Simon Van Dyke trying to get back on the racing surface. So let's see what happened there. So there he was. I think he was in front of the race leaders, by the way. Making a mistake here, you will see. Ooh, he was in a precarious position. And I think, yes, that's Ashton. And then you will see Van Buell go by. Okay, so Beard and Shermans are back at it. So holding on and thinking they will not... well, I wanted to do the class recap, but I think this fight... might come to a conclusion very, very soon.
And Dave Fuller as well catching up to James Forsyth. Forsyth's had a couple of tricky laps on that last lap. Beard closed in by 9/10 of a second. Wasn't even that strong a lap from Beard. 1:30. You think he's been racing in the 28s at some points in this race. So both, I think, maybe getting a little bit held up behind the traffic. That is Kevin De Winter, I guess, just in front of them. Or maybe even Kim Bayet. Kim De Winter, I believe. Now, the Mercedes really is very close into the chicane. Just not quite getting the mistake yet from Shermans. This perhaps his best opportunity to pounce.
I see. Must be something brewing. Sam, if you look in our Discord just above us, there are some pretty big names having a chat. We cannot say anything. I'm hoping that this is due to the C-bar issue and trying to do something. It's an ever-evolving world. This one of sim racing, especially these last couple of weeks. I mean, you never know what's coming up next. If there's a moment of for a racing not to avoid as many technical issues as possible, this is it. As Beard is again, he has done this whole race, catching up to Nick Shermans and then trying to find the right moment to make the move and not mastering the confidence, the courage, or you know, he's just making some very smart risk assessment.
Well, I mean, there's no F1 on at the moment, but at least this racing is very much replicating it. he can't get past. He's got a few tenths of a second, but yeah, he can't get past.
Reminds me of the left guard there.
There is
this
the mistake from Lennartz, and now Shermans has got to go defensive. He's got to go right.
No.
He doesn't have to go right. He's absolutely fine. Don't listen to me. Beard wasn't close enough regardless.
And lifted very early, in my opinion.
Oh, Forsyth is now only 3 seconds behind these guys as well. I think he just closed in by about 2 seconds in the last couple of laps. And now Beard is really close to the inside, into the hairpin. Surely this time he is alongside. Shermans is going to have to leave him space. Round the outside goes, or down the inside goes Beard. He'll have the outside for the chicane. And this is a very precarious position to be on the outside. And now he is ahead. It's taken him almost the entire race. But Ashley Beard is finally up into fourth place. And that is a few handy points in the championship. Sherman still leader of the Silver Drivers. He is in fifth. And that was a pretty nice move in the end. A bit of traffic helping him out. Meanwhile, out in the front, Simon Van Buell just lost half a second, 4/10 of a second on that last lap. Ashton is closing in on this fixed victory.
It's going to be close,
also,
eh?
Between Hessels and Mushti.
Going to be close if this is the final lap or not, as you're right, Hessels and Mujdi are going at it.
I think we'll get one more in. Half a minute to go. It's a pretty slow end to the lap, isn't it? It'll be close, yeah.
Something happened. Ashley Beard is around.
Oh, no. Oh, dear. Fourth place. Championship leader is down into seventh place now. And Hessels and Mustier are both approaching. Doesn't seem like there's too much damage on that car. Here it is. Oh, it takes too much first curve, too much second curve, and bosh, into the wall. Was fortunate they could get back going quite so quick.
One more lap.
Yep. Oh, you know what? He didn't cross the line in time, but iRacing are a little bit generous. And despite crossing the line, probably about 1.5 seconds after the hour mark, we will have one more lap, which could make some difference with the fuel. And look at this. Back markers, front runners. David Fuller might get fifth place out of this.
Someone is asking about Agustin Canapino. Very prominent iRacer and, of course, Turismo Carretera champion. Lamentablemente, Agustino no está en esta carrera, Adrian. Hopefully, maybe in the future, who knows? I'd love to have some Turismo Carretera drivers here on Apex Racing TV. And Agustin is always at the forefront, of course, being very active in iRacing.
Oh, Fuller with a nice run. He really managed to gain a car length or so on force take. Don't think it's going to happen into the chicane. Does feel the need to defend, though. Does the year one driver? Oh, needed to be early on the brakes in order just to avoid the back marker. Like I said, Hessels and Mustier also quite close. So I don't think Mustier is going to quite be able to do that one. Both catching up to Beard. Out in the lead, though. Jack Ashton, who won out at Bathurst. He crashed out last time out at Watkins Glen. But he's going to be the first driver this season to take two race victories. Jack Ashton wins at Zolder. Second place again is Stijn van Buhl. Joseph Janowski is going to get his first ever podium in the championship from pole position. And Shermans is going to win out of the silver drivers. Forsdijk is just going to hold on, I think, against Fuller. There's no run to the line, I think, on this occasion. Yeah, Fuller hangs on. Forsdijk hangs on. Also, Mustier versus Hessels. Mustier has got ahead of Hessels on the run to the line, seemingly. I think we might have to get a replay of that one because it didn't look like anything was going to happen between the two drivers. But it does seem to have happened right at the end. And here we are.
Victory for Pinbaum in bronze. There is no one left behind him in his class, so he will be a bit understanding of us if we just very quickly show this replay. I'm very, very shocked that our friend Adrian understood something of my terrible Spanish. But yeah, here we go.
It's not going to happen at this point, does it? How does this happen? Oh, he lets him past.
Okay.
I don't know what that's about. I don't think he... I mean, at no point did he overtake the other way around. There is a pin belt for Revmatch Esports Academy coming home. 13th place overall and his bronze victory. And I can't remember the last time that... Bao won in the bronze class. Certainly not this season. I think he did get a couple last season, but that is some good points for him. Seen a number of bronze class victors so far. If you don't count Nayer back when he was classified as a bronze driver. So here we are then with the finish, and we can go through the final results. So this round five of the DynamiXX Sim Racers World GT Championship.
Cannot find.
Have you got the standing?
Yeah, I cannot find the results component because it's so far away in my project file. Here we go.
Nice one. So Jack Ashton wins out for Team Fordzilla. That late spin made it a bit difficult, didn't it? Simon van Buhl, would he have won if it weren't for that back markers? Should the back markers be blamed for the for him not winning?
I don't Never. Know.
Maybe some anger.
Respect the back markers.
Respect the back markers, yes. But it made a difference. It certainly cost him a few seconds in those few laps. Van Buhl didn't quite have the pace to catch up to Ashton. Another second place for him to back up that second place at Sebring. Joseph Janowski finishes in third place. Top of the silver drivers was Nick Sherman's, and dominating silver class victory as well. In fourth place overall, James Forsdyke gets fifth. More great points for Forsdyke. He's having a great season. David Fuller, that's his second best result ever in this championship, I think, to go alongside his Bathurst results. He's really got some... this is turning into a good season for David Fuller for Quantum Racing. Then it was Ashley Beard after a late spin. Still, seventh place, not too bad. Dries Moujdi rounding out the podium for the silver drivers. Then Jeremy Hessels and Adam Murray rounding out the top 10. Then a massive gap back to PJ Claessens. He was over a minute off the lead in the end after starting from the back. Matthias Tem was in 12th. Top of the bronze drivers was Pim Bao for Rev Match Academy. And then the only other driver on the lead lap was Paul Gosling. Then one lap down was Thijs Vandenberg, James Hobden, Kevin De Winter, Kim Byheit, Jochen Lennartz, Simon Van Dyke, Stuart Musselwhite was two laps down. And then the proper retirees were Stephen DeWolf, John McConville, Lee Deamer, Justin Nyer, Ben Llewellyn, Sebastian Hawkins, Bod Boland, John Tusting, Steve Claes, Neil Cooper, Ryan Walker, Chris Moretta, Ronald Moons, Hendrik de Grave, and Lee Woodburn. So, interviews. We always get some interviews. And we are going to get an interview. Brilliant. With our race winner for today. It's Jack Ashton. Congratulations, Jack. First up, take us through those first few laps. You were keeping Janowski very honest, and eventually you got a mistake out of him.
Yeah. I knew I had it in me for the pace today. Practice went supremely well when I was looking at everyone else's time. So come to quali, and I didn't really put the lap in I wanted, and I just never got round to it. Luckily got a podium, which I'm happy with. So I knew straight away I had to try and hassle who was around me to try and get forwards as quick as possible and get the gap. And obviously, yeah, quick bit of hassling behind him, and it forced an error, which is happy. But yeah, got a nice little lead, and tried to keep that as best I could, really. So it's a good race, really. Happy with that.
Definitely. And then late on, hearts in mouth moments, a mistake from Noah. I hope you'll watch the stream back later on, but I was very complimentary of your incredibly consistent lap times, and then all of a sudden, I see you facing the wrong way.
Well, I'll tell you what, I see the gap was about 10 seconds, and I thought, oh, if I give him, I give it a little 7-second spin, then it will give Van Buhl a bit of confidence. Nah, I'm joking. Yeah, that was certainly a bit of a heart in mouth moment. I won't be doing that again in the future. In the future, let's hope. But yeah, I was saying a few choice words to myself at that time. But yeah, good thing it wasn't live.
Definitely. And this Zolder circuit, we saw lots of mistakes. The walls are pretty close around this place. The curbs are very daunting. How did you find it? I mean, are you a big fan of this place, and how comfortable were you with the circuit by the end?
I was super scared of this track because I've never driven it. I was supposed to do it in the BSR MX5 series last season, but I missed that round and I've never driven it. I literally bought the track last week and first time I've driven it. So I was really scared. And yeah, the curbs are crazily hard to get right. But once you master it, you can get round it quite nicely. And by the end of it, I think it's probably one of my favourite tracks. I love it. It's awesome. Yeah, I've got a little bit of tutoring as well from a good friend of mine, Will Trigurfer from Mivano Sim Racing, and he's taught me a few things and it's really helped. So maybe some more pace to come, let's hope.
Definitely. You're the first driver this season to win two races. This is the fifth meeting of the championship. You're in second place in the title and have closed the gap, of course, to championship leader Ashley Beard. How are you thinking about the championship yet? Is that affecting your driving at all, or is 100%. It just taking each race as it
goes? No, yeah, championship is always on the mind. Keeping that two drop rounds in mind now. I've had the bad round, last round at Watkins Glen, with the obvious chaos that happened on that first lap. We won't talk much about it. And then Daytona round was a bit poor, so I'm keeping them rounds as my drop scores from now on and keep my level head, and let's see if we can get some good points. So far it's been quite good. I think two wins and a third, so if I can keep that up onwards now, then it's in fighting chance for a good spot in the championship points. So yeah, happy for that.
And next up we head to Monza, quite a different circuit to this. What do you think about that one?
Draft fest for qualifying for sure. It's not one of my favourable tracks for sure. Just find it a tad boring, to be honest with you. But I do okay there. So let's see what happens. Do a bit of practice now. I'm not at work, so bit of a funny situation we're all in at the moment, isn't it?
Yeah, certainly is. A few extra hours of practice. I'm sure you're not even going to need them, though, Jack. You're very strong today, as always. Before we let you go, is there anyone you'd like to thank?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank all the guys at Team Fordzilla. Everyone there does a great job. Still building that team now, and it's getting stronger by the day. So looking forward to spending more future with them again. And obviously you guys for the stream. Cracking effort at the stream. Really good. Love watching it back. So yeah, I think that's about it.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Jack. And see you next week.
Yeah, thank you.
And Marco, strangely, the drivers haven't come flocking as they always do. However, we do have another driver waiting in the booth.
Absolutely. We will have David Fuller. Hello, David.
Hello, guys. How's it doing?
Doing fine. How about you? I mean, it was a very, very good result. Podium in class, sixth place overall, considering that this is a track where a lot of crazy things can happen. It was a good haul of points to bring home.
Yeah, I think just lady luck was on my side tonight, I think. I only jumped in here to see if Nick was about, because I just want to congratulate Nick, because he had a fantastic race. Great pace. So if he's watching, congratulations, mate, as well deserved win.
Well, so how was it, of course this is a very, very strange racetrack with some, it's very narrow, those chicanes, of course, you really need to have not only some good pace, but also need be super careful and be careful of who's driving around you, because it only takes one small, as we have seen at the start of the race, takes one small mistake by someone, and then your race could be over very, very quickly.
Yeah, you're right. Those damn curbs. The last chicane was horrendous for me. I was saying to the guys in the team in the Discord, for some reason, I was hitting that inside the first left on the last chicane every single time. But I eventually got it in the end. But yeah, the start, there was some drama at the start. Luckily, everybody around me slowed down the same as me and just sort of filtered through. And then I was a bit in no man's land, to be honest. I was a few seconds in front, a few seconds behind, but a bit of time just to settle into the track, really. I struggled to, I can't remember who it was, to get past somebody. I was behind them for quite a few laps, which was quite nice, actually, just a little bit of a battle there. And then I was behind Hessels. And I don't know how, but I managed to get an extra lap to everybody else, I think. I'm not sure how that happened, because I wasn't fuel saving, but it seemed to work out for us. I jumped Hessels in the pit stop. So yeah, good result. Good result for Paul as well. I think we're just wanting to finish more than anything else.
So next week, Monza, of course, track similar to this, but also very different. Of course, we have the longer straights, still those chicanes to contend with. Are you looking forward to it?
I am, yeah. You get to have a drink of your beer when you're driving at Monza, and tonight I had a beer with us and it stayed there the whole race. I didn't have one chance to drink my beer, and it was bloody warm when I finished, so can't wait for Monza where I can have a few swigs.
Awesome, David. Well, congratulations once again. Before we let you go, anyone you'd like to thank?
You guys for the broadcast, the team for putting up with all the moaning and bitching and bickering that we do over the course of the week. the stewards, a special mention to the stewards. They put a post on earlier today or yesterday, and there's been quite a lot of chat about how they can improve the stewarding. To be honest, I don't think there's any right answers, but all credit to them for opening up the floor to us guys. I don't think, like I say, there'll be a right answer, but I just want to thank them. And Ian, thanks for all he's been doing in the background. I haven't had a chance to thank him, so I'll take that opportunity now. He's stepping down from the main admin role and what have you, so all the best to him and his family, and I hope everything works out for him.
Awesome, David. Well, congratulations once again, and hopefully we will catch you next week.
Yeah, hopefully. Catch you there, guys.
And that was David Fuller. Sam, as a very last-minute surprise, well, the racing action is not over on Apex Racing TV just yet for today. Or maybe for today, yes, if you are living in Europe, but it will be still today if you live in North America. Because we have a very, 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 very last-minute addition to our roster of series. It will start tonight at 1:15 GMT on our Apex Racing TV channel. It's a five-race schedule for the DCRA Championship. They will be using the Porsche GT4 Cayman car around some of the best racetracks in North America and Virginia International Raceway. So you don't want to miss that. First race is tonight, 1:15 GMT, and at Road Atlanta with yours truly and Austin Knight that will join us. Sam, hopefully you got my very, very classy way of expressing my dislike for Virginia International Raceway.
Well, don't diss the Grand West circuit. Is it the Grand West circuit?
I only know that it's Virginia. We don't know the... I don't know the...
Okay.
The, but we're going to go twice to Road Atlanta, to Barber, to Sebring International. Hopefully the full layout. And again, so there's fantastic racetracks plus Virginia International Raceway. So,
yeah. it's absolutely true. You've just actually reminded me how we're getting ominously closer to Motegi in this championship at night as well, as though that place needs to be at night. Oh dear. Anyway, Motegi's a while away. Next week will be Monza, of course, in the DynamiXX Simracersworld GT Championship. Certainly to catch that one. That'll be on at the same time. Of course, if you've enjoyed this video, leave a like on it, and also subscribe to the iRacing Esports Network, because there are some other good videos on here. I'm sure about it. You might even see Verstappen and Norris. They are on here very, very occasionally.
Well, we had Lando in the MX5 a few years ago. I raced against him
a couple of years ago. Wow! Yeah.
In Monza, in the BSR MX5. I don't think it was. I don't think the Esports Network was a thing already then, or it was just beginning, so it was on our channel, but I remember he did race one, race two, and then he had to take the plane because he was racing in F2 that weekend, of course. So, and it was weird to see that MX-5 in full McLaren colors. That was, and he also collided with one of my teammates in that race.
He wasn't taking it particularly seriously, if I recall correctly. He did do very well, though. He is a decent driver. Of course, do check out Apex Racing TV as well, where you can see all the videos we post on the Esports Network. We are now broadcasting them simultaneously, so certainly do check out Apex Racing TV. You can see many more broadcasts like this, and of course, do check out our Twitch channel, our Facebook page, our Twitter page, and all of that stuff. Instagram as well. Do check out all of that. And of course, do check out next round of the championship, round 6 of the DynamiXX Simracersworld GT series next week, same time. But for now, for me and for Marco, we're going to say goodbye, and we'll see you next time.